The doors appear to be closing, which I guess means it's time for us to get started. Thanks everyone for joining on day three. How many people have been here the whole time, like since Monday? Everybody. Good. Well, then I think I made the right decision to go real light on slides. So I've got like only five slides that I'm going to show. The rest of the time, what I thought I'd do is kind of a real-time demonstration and walk through some of the solutions that I'm going to be talking about to sort of address cloud security in a new and different way, right? To get out in front of your applications, whether they're on-premises or they're out in the cloud or they're running on mobile device in our pocket. There's a lot of policy that we can put in place. I think it's kind of getting to be the right thing to do. As our employees are bringing in more and more apps, this is kind of a way for IT to get our arms back around that, control those apps, manage which ones are in use, which ones are not, and how they can get be reached, right? So with that, I'm Chris Weber with Centrify. There's a few of us that are going to be talking today. Thanks again for coming out and listening. I come to Centrify with a security background. I look after our cloud products here. Before, I was at Blue Coat Systems, Zscaler, got some mobile security background at Good Technology, and bring that all here because this is a great play. I think it's where everybody is going. I've worked for companies where everyone has been, so I'm happy to be here and sort of pushing things a little bit forward. Before I did any of that stuff, though, I was an IT guy. I looked after the network, and I looked after mobility at the time, but mobility at that time wasn't as cool as it is now, right? We had flip phones. We had the occasional, like, a bar of soap tablet smartphone that ran to Windows operating system but didn't do a whole lot. We were still on-premises Exchange exclusively, and things have really grown and changed since then. And I'm trying to sort of marry those two backgrounds, right? The IT practitioner, security guy, for whom everything was going to be my fault if it didn't go right, with the product guy, for whom I maybe can provide a solution as long as it actually works for me when I was back in the IT desk. So with that, what I see as a real problem is that we have a lot of challenges today. These aren't so different from what they used to be, but it's a new context that makes them different. We've got more users than ever, right? Accessing more devices than ever. I have a tablet, I have an iOS device, and I have an Android device in my pocket. I have a Mac, and I have a Windows machine. That's just for work, right? I think that's common for a lot of folks. Everybody at least has a smartphone and a laptop. I'm gonna jiggle this cable and make sure it's not me. Anyway, more users than ever, accessing more devices than ever, that can get to more apps than ever, some of which are inside our firewall and under our control, many of which are not. They're either natively out there on the device themselves, or they're out in the cloud. Maybe there's some that are still behind our firewall. Maybe this flickering is kind of an exciting thing. It's almost like a rave. If we brought the lights down, we could have it go back and forth. But this problem means that we don't have the control and visibility we're used to. We don't necessarily have a single way to get folks in and out of all of this. So what we need to do is get holistically in charge of all the apps, no matter where they are, of all the devices as well, because if you don't secure the device, it's hard to secure the app data that that device has access to. Interesting. I see the projector's kind of flickering on and off. Maybe it's the right time to take a little pause. Is it me? Yes. Cable wiggling. Nobody knows cable wiggling better. Second display port. It's a perfect BYOD situation right now. They said, use this Mac that we've provided for you. And I said, nah, I'm going to use my own. And now I'm the problem. See? This is the bummer. So, in any case, all those applications, some of which are on-prem, some of them are not, the problem that we see here is you need one holistic solution to manage the devices and the applications that are being accessed from those devices. Something that can provide single sign-on so users don't forget their passwords and start calling the help desk left, right, and center. Something that can provision users out, which we're going to go through today in detail. Something that can also manage the devices, so provide security and policy on those devices, provide a way to push applications to the devices, provide an easy way to get into apps without fat-fingering passwords with your thumbs and getting them wrong and getting locked out, and also maybe use those devices as a second factor of authentication as part of policy for cloud apps, whether or not the cloud apps understand multi-factor auth. And I'll show all of that today. This is just another way of saying that, right? I won't go through all this in detail, but you'll see today that the right solutions for managing your cloud applications need to be pretty broad. It can't just be single sign-on, one of these six things. That's a good solution for end users. It means that they only have one username and password to remember, and that's good. But if it doesn't do everything else that we have here, if it doesn't provide policy, if it doesn't do MFA, if it's not a complete device management solution as well, then there's going to be holes in our strategy. So we want something a little more robust, a little more end-to-end. And this will be my last slide before I go into the demo, because I promised I'd keep them limited. This is really what we're going to be going over today, what I'm going to show in real time. So back when I was in IT, we still had to do this, right? We had to set up users on their first day and get them productive. Then we had to make sure they had the right access to the right stuff. As they kept working, I had to make sure if they got a new phone that I set the phone up the right way, or if they swapped laptops that I had the right applications on that new laptop before I took the other one away and did the data transfer. I had to give them some way that I controlled for them to get into the stuff they used. I had it kind of easy. We had a big Windows domain based in Active Directory. All the applications talked to it. They were all local. So I'd set them up in AD and tear them down. It started getting hard when people started traveling and using mobile devices. And then I didn't know where they were going. And it was harder to connect them back to my infrastructure without complex VPN. I had to set that up. I had to always manage the configuration. I had to manage which concentrator they were going to all the time. And if they were going from one coast to the other, sometimes it'd be real slow and I'd get help desk calls. And then the thing that most stressed me out actually about all this is that last one, that little X on the side, offboard. It sounds like nothing. But I don't know if this is the same for any of you or if any of you are in the same position, but when a new user joined, I always knew I had at least 2 weeks to set them up and give them access to everything they did, because they had to quit their last job. So I'd get the hiring manager say, you know, we're going to hire Johnny, and Johnny needs access to all this stuff. So I'd say, okay, Johnny, here's, you know, get a laptop for him, provision the apps, ghost image, we're good. Maybe you needed to get a device. I would buy that because we didn't do BYOD at the time. And he needed VPN access. He needed to be in the domain. I'd set it up. I had 2 weeks. I could kind of take my time, get it in whenever I needed. And if I got it wrong and Johnny started, it took him a week or two to figure out he didn't have something. And he'd come down to the desk and I'd set it up. So really, I had 2 weeks to do it, but it was like really 3 years if I got it wrong because he wasn't going to notice. The problem was when Johnny got fired, which where I worked happened often, Johnny, I'd get a letter on Friday, a term notice that said, Johnny's canned, terminate all his access to everything by 6 o'clock today. So I didn't have 2 weeks. I didn't have 3 years, that's for sure. I had a matter of hours to figure out what he had access to, from what devices, collect everything, shut it off, and prove it to a lawyer, my general counsel or someone on her team, and say, don't worry, Johnny, our lead sales guy, isn't going to take all his accounts to the next company. Or Johnny, our marketing person, isn't going to pull all that vendor information and all of our budgets and shift them out the door. That's when I got stressed out, because instead of having a lot of time, I had a little time. And if he had worked there 5 years, how do I know what he still had access to, right? I know what I set up originally, but then he worked with his manager and got something over here. He used his own Salesforce, well, probably not Salesforce, maybe a Box instance, right? I don't know where that stuff all was. It started being stressful. So if we can automate this, which I'm going to show today, the user setup and the teardown, we can eliminate, I hope, a lot of those kind of anxious moments on Fridays when we're trying to tear somebody down. We hear a lot about provisioning. I think what's most important is deprovisioning, taking the access away and making sure you can prove this guy doesn't have access to anything anymore. So with that, I'm going to jump out of presentation mode here. I'm going to switch over to a couple of different screens. What we're going to see on this screen here, this is Google Apps, right? We're going to see an administrator's view. This is sort of the IT day in the life. When I switch over to this side, what we're going to see is an end user view. And I'll be mirroring a mobile device, if I can make it move, and I'll be showing the applications that this user is going to be accessing on this screen. So you'll see me switch back and forth. I'll try not to do it so much to make everybody seasick. First, I'm going to be the IT guy. I'm going to set up a new user like we saw on the diagram I just showed. Then I'm going to switch to that user, show what it looks like to have this single sign-on, and then I'm going to fire that guy, and we're going to see what it looks like. Does that make sense? All right, so I'll take a little time to do that. The reason I've started in Google Apps is because there's only one user today in Google Apps, and that's Jeff. Jeff, I just saw out in front of the hotel. He was getting in an Uber to go back home. He worked at the show this week, but he's my guinea pig test user and product. There's no one else in here. The only reason I show that is because I'm going to automatically add someone else. I want to prove that it works. So that's all you need to know is that inside Google Apps for Business, in the admin console, I only have one user, and it's Jeff. The way I'm going to go in here is we're going to pretend Johnny's starting today, and I'm an IT guy. So I'm Chris, right? And I'm using my super secret demo environment. So I'm logging in as Chris at demo to go ahead and create this new user. Now, if this works as planned, it's going over Wi-Fi on my mobile device, which I'm going to leave out here. And I'll tell you why that is in just a second. But now I'm going to enter my super secret trade show password, which some of you will probably be able to guess before the end of this presentation. But it's just for this one demo. And when I get in, what we'll see here is where I can manage all the users, all the applications, all the devices, and all the security policy across all of it so that I have one-stop shopping, right? I have one place to go to secure my end users. I'm going to skip our little introductory wizard because we're not going to go through that today. But here's the users, apps, devices, policies, roles, right? Everything you might expect to manage something, say, in Active Directory, but in the cloud, available from anywhere, and across many things. So if I go into the users, what we'll see here when the list populates, I have two different kinds of users. I've got cloud users, and I have folks that are in Active Directory. Actually, I have three kinds because I have two different flavors of AD set up. But that allows me to do a couple of different things. If I already have on-premises AD, and I already have all my users in there, I can just proxy back to that information when I set something up like I'm going to do today. I don't have to sync AD and copy everything and put it out in the cloud and then figure out how to keep two databases in sync. I just proxy back with a simple 5-minute cloud connector that we install behind the firewall, uses an outbound 443 connection to talk to the cloud when necessary, right? Very simple, very easy. I also have cloud users. Think of these as maybe contractors or people that are going to stay at the company for a short period of time. I don't want to pollute AD with a million ads, moves, and changes. I think that's a good best practice, right? I keep them in a separate directory. I keep them in the cloud. That way I can be moving those guys left, right, and center. So I'm going to create a cloud user today, and that's how I'm going to set this up, just for the sake of ease, so I don't have to switch back and forth between yet another kind of interface going into AD. So we talked about Johnny, right? He's going to be Johnny at demo, because this is the environment I'm using. So this is nothing secret here. I just want to set it up all the way from the very beginning. Johnny, you guys can watch me type, which is always very thrilling. At Centrify Now is the domain I want to use there. And he's going to, anybody have, what's a fun last name? Johnny Watson. Wasn't there a guitar player? Johnny Guitar Watson? I think so. He's going to have a super secret password as well. And this would be the one username and password I would give to Johnny on his first day, to get him into everything that he uses for his job. Now, I would probably make it a better password, and if it was a real thing, I'd have him set his own right away. But since we're doing a demo, I'm just going to say that this is his password and never expires. And just for grins, I'm going to put in a phone number for him, 555-1243. I'm going to create this user. Oh, no, he's my employee. What the heck? This is fun. So he's going to work for this guy, and we're ready. When I create this user in the cloud, that's all I've really done. I've just made a record for Johnny. Nothing special there. But it's the first of two steps that are the only two steps I need to do when I create this user. So when we see this thing come back, again, over my network that's trying really hard, if any of you are on AT&T, you'll be competing with me. When I see it come back, Johnny will have been created, but he's not going to be a member of any roles. He's not going to have any applications. He's just a name. I'm going to associate that name with some of these roles. And I can show you just exactly how I'm going to do that now. Maybe we'll skip, and as this thing is loading, we'll be able to see just what's going on. I have all these roles that are here, and these could map back to Active Directory if that's how I wanted to do it. But the easiest thing for me to do here just to show you is I've got a sales role, because Johnny's a sales guy. So I'm going to add Johnny to the sales role, and he's going to get the applications that sales folks need to do their jobs, we think, because we're still good. Awesome. Johnny is going to get a whole bunch of applications that are provided in here. He's going to get these. So you're going to see Box and Concur. You're going to see a few versions of Box up there because I don't know whether Johnny uses Android or iOS, and I want to push the native client as well as the client he's going to use from his laptop. So that's why you see a few versions of Box, Concur, and all the other apps a salesperson might use on day one, right? And you might be saying, Chris, didn't you start this whole thing in Google Apps for Business? Why don't I see that? Well, it's because I wanted to show that we can do nested roles. So I also have a group called Google Apps for Business, and sales is a member of that group. So all of the apps there flow down to the next one. So it's very flexible. If I go here to the Google Apps for Business role and I show the assigned applications there, this is where you're going to see the Google Apps stuff. And if I look in members, we'll see that sales is a member, so they flow through. So it's real flexible, real easy. So what I'm going to do is go back to my sales role, and I'm going to add Johnny to that role. And those are the only two steps I'm going to need to do for IT to have a new user up and running day one. If I wasn't talking, and if I had a fast connection, that would take, what, 30 seconds maybe to type the username and password? I'd be off and running and onto a new project. So here's where I can add a new person. I'm going to look for Johnny. Johnny Guitar Watson. I'm going to add him into sales, and then I'm going to save that. That's it. That's the end of my work for setting up a new employee. I don't have to take the 2 weeks anymore like I talked about before. I don't have to hassle with the, oops, I forgot this app or that app, because it's automatically done based on role, based on policy. I think this is kind of the thing that I want folks to kind of take away is automation can be really good when it takes time out of our day and saves that for us to focus on bigger projects. At this point, what we'll see is that Johnny's been built. I'll switch over to Johnny and I'll show that all the applications that he has are available to him on a mobile device as well as his laptop. That's why I have this screen over here. And, oh, and I'd be remiss if I didn't also show, hopefully the network is fast, that when I go back into Google Apps for Business, Johnny's been automatically provisioned, set up, given a license, and has the right tools and access here. So if I refresh here, now I may have beat it, depending on how fast this network is, but if I refresh, what I should see, oops, I have to re-sign in, is that Jeff is still there in users, and Johnny should be there as well as a, there he is, Johnny Watson. I never went into Google, I never set him up. It's automatically done on the back end, and he's got all the right stuff, right? When Johnny's canned, we can automatically pull him back all the same way. So at this point, I'll switch over. I'm no longer an IT guy. Now I'm actually Johnny, right? And it's my first day on the job. I've brought my own mobile device. It could be iOS. Today I have an Android device up just because that's what I had available to me. I'll probably, if I'm Johnny, have both so I can sort of have the right thing to talk to customers, whatever it may be. And you can see my device is up on the screen. I know you can't see it from there, but this is the same screen. Little bit of lag, but you'll see me go here to the next page. This is my own personal device. I'm Johnny. I've got some games on here. I've got whatever it may be, right? So there's a lot of my own data. The last thing I want is to have that all gone. I want to still use my corporate applications, and I want to use my own stuff. I'm a BYOD kind of guy. That's me. I'm Johnny. So IT, remember, gave me my one username and my one password to get everything set up. So I've also got, they also told me to download the Centrify app. They could have pushed a text to my device that said, go get this app, because it's not enrolled in email yet, right? It's very easy for me to go, okay, this is clearly where I enter my one username. I'm Johnny at demo. And my one super secret password, which is hopefully I don't mess up. And I sign in. You'll see the device will then enroll. It goes up to the cloud. In this case, it's talking to us, and it says, hey, this guy wants to enroll his phone in our device management. It has a lot of policy that's there, and now I've enrolled it automatically. It's going and talking to the cloud and saying, hey, what does IT allow you to do, Johnny? It's going to see which web applications can you use, which mobile native applications can you use, and immediately, there's my list of apps that we saw provisioned for Johnny. Right away, day one, here he is, ready to go, right? Johnny doesn't know what the passwords are to any of these apps, but he doesn't need one. It's all set up with SAML on the back end. When I click Box, I use the built-in browser to get in there, and I'm going to get single sign-on into Box. I don't even know what username or password I might use. I'm dumb Johnny, right? My job is to go sell stuff for the company. Once I'm in, here's all the stuff that IT wants me to have. The beauty of that is on the back end, Johnny can have that taken away. The only way I know how to get in is through this. Or some of you may be saying, people like to use native apps. They don't want to use the web app. That's fine. I have those here pushed out to the device as well. In the background, I've got my Box app. I could log in through that as well, right? SAML can get me in there. I don't need another username and password. It's all set up for me day one so I can be productive. So Johnny says, not bad. Now I guess I should log in from my laptop and make sure that everything's going to work there too. So I'll stick this guy down right here. Same username and password. You guys are going to be expecting that I'll see the same applications, and that's because you're smart, and that's because you know it's right. Did I spell Johnny right? So when I use my laptop, you'll see right away there's this additional factor that's required, a mobile authenticator. In IT, one of my policies is, I haven't seen this device before. Make this guy multi-factor auth, please, because I don't know if I want to trust that anybody could steal Johnny at demo and get into this thing. So I'll enter my password, and then we'll see that is not my password. That is the fat-fingered version. See if I got this right. I'm going to use the mobile authenticator here. There's a few different options. We could use a text out to the device if Johnny didn't have a smartphone. We could do a voice call, same reason, right? And it could say, hey, are you really trying to log in? Press 1 if this is really you. We can do a lot of different things for here, but for the sake of ease, I'm going to use the mobile authenticator and click Next. Before Johnny's let in, It jumps up. I just felt a vibration on my wrist. You guys can't see that, but Android Wear just got a notification. And you can see this, Centrify Mobile Authenticator. Do you really want to log in? So I'll go back here and I'll say, yes, I certainly do really want to log in. My device goes up to the cloud, says, this is me. And then you'll see the cloud says, hey, browser, this guy has multi-factor auth. He could have done it from his watch, done it from his phone. And now he's in. Give him access to the apps that he needs. For this version, I set that up because I hadn't recognized this computer before. And that's the gateway to all apps. I put multi-factor authentication in front of every app Johnny may use. I could have chosen to only put it in front of specific apps inside the portal, make it easy to log in, but maybe I really want to protect Box and Dropbox and Google, for example. Or maybe what I want to do is say, when I see a device I haven't seen before, challenge for multi-factor. Or if it's on a weird network, challenge for multi-factor. Or if it's in this location or this time of day, the policy is flexible. It's up to you. It's up to IT to decide. Make it easy for people that are in the office between the hours of 8 and 5. Don't challenge them for multi-factor. They're in the right place. They're on the right devices. Let them in. But if it's somewhere weird, then challenge, right, or block. This is all up to IT to set up. So we saw that same list of apps on the device over here that Johnny has access to if I go back to the app list. So no matter what device Johnny's using, he's got access to the right applications that he needs to do his job. If I click here, you'll also see, without entering anything separate, I'll be singly signed on into Box, and there's the same list of applications, or excuse me, list of files, right? From Johnny's perspective, this was all pretty easy. Johnny has one username and password that he enters on anything that he uses, and he's productive. What he's certainly not doing is calling the help desk and going, how do I get into Workday? He knows where Workday is, it's a big old W, and he clicks it, right? This is a pretty good solution for him. The other thing, and now, I used to be an IT guy, I probably wouldn't let a user have this, but my savvy folks, my IT users, maybe my product management folks, maybe my engineers, I would let them have access to this, and that's why this is flexible. What Johnny can do in this demo is he can actually manage, in some sense, his own device. So let's go looking. Johnny can see, here's the device I have enrolled. We can see, well, the map's a little zoomed in. Here's where that device is. And if we could zoom in further, it would show this kiosk, right? Isn't that where we are? Here. So he knows, I didn't leave it in the hotel. It's at my house. I don't need to panic and call IT and say, can you please wipe my device? I just need to turn around and drive home. That'll be easy, right? He can actually go in and click that device, see a lot of information. IT can see this information as well. How much battery is remaining? How much storage is in use? Which applications are actually on the device, including those personal apps, right? There's the list of apps that are running here. Where it is, we can see device activity, which will be a real short list because we just deployed it. But we also can take some action. So Johnny can do some neat things. If he's going to leave this, if it's a tablet and he wants his kids to play with it for the weekend, he can just go ahead and disable single sign-on so the kids don't accidentally go into the app and start messing around in his work stuff. He can re-enable it when it's back. If he leaves it in a cab, calls the cab company, do you have my phone? Yes. Maybe all he does is he just locks it. Or maybe he disables SSO. He picks it up later. Again, for my sophisticated users, I might let them do this. For those that are maybe less sophisticated or apt to be clumsy, I'll do this, but IT has this exact same level of control over here in the IT world. They can control that device, they can manage it. Because it's managed and enrolled in the same service, I can put policy on the device, just like I can put policy in front of those apps, and they're all integrated into one nice, easy ticket. So Johnny's got everything he needs. He's ready to go. The device has turned dark. But you get the idea that he's good on day one, right, doing his job. I'm going to switch back over to IT Town here, go back to my cloud manager, and we're going to pretend it's been a year, and turns out Johnny's a clown, right? He's just not so good at his job. He was supposed to sell a lot of stuff for me. He didn't sell a lot of stuff for me. This is a real story. I heard a guy recently, inside sales guy, not at our company, but a friend, friend's company. The guy was dialing random numbers that didn't go to anything, and talking into a headset as he walked around the office and sort of looked like very serious all day to nothing. Like, isn't that harder than actually, anyway, it's a real story. The guy was just talking to nothing and then going home, but he was on an auto dialer, and the auto dialer was like, this guy does 300 calls a day. He's burning through it. He's the best on the team. They didn't, until they started recording, so that's a top tip. Have your SDRs recorded, if you use any, to make sure they're actually talking to human beings. It blew my mind. Anyway. So maybe that's the guy. Maybe Johnny's the guy who's making fake phone calls and just having an imaginary conversation in his head. I need to get rid of him. All I need to do Just like it was only two steps to set them up, it's really only one step to take it away. So if I go back, oh, not to apps, if I go to users, I find Johnny in the list. I could do this in Active Directory as well. I could suspend Johnny's user, right? Here, just for the sake of I really hate that guy, I'm going to actually delete him entirely. So let's find him. Here's Johnny. Oh, Johnny, I'm so sorry. I got the term notice. It's a Friday. This used to be a stressful situation. Now all I'm going to do, you're done. Delete Johnny. Are you sure? Let's make sure. That says Johnny at demo in the background. Yes, I'm sure. You see the cloud up here told me, now deleting one user. Now I can go back to my business. When general counsel comes into my office and says, hey, does Johnny have all of our sales records? Can he still get into Salesforce.com? Can he still get into Google Apps for Business and download all his information? I feel a lot better about saying, no, he can't get that. Because if I switch over here, you'll see Johnny, I did this on purpose, he's still got a list of applications, right? He's over here thinking, hey, I'm good. I can still click box and get single sign-on. We're going to see what happens when he tries, right? It's going through us. It's going over the slow network. It's going to try to single sign him in, and it's going to say, who are you again? I don't know you at all. Even though your session was open, every time I go into box, I need to authenticate again. And when it goes to authenticate, it says, you're not going to get there from here. And he says, oh, yeah, I've got my mobile phone. I'll outfox you, IT. I'm going to steal those last pieces of data. This is where I stand on my tiptoes at the edge of the demo zone. And it says, hey, we're going to try to get you in. Your user's deleted. He cannot get to Box. He can't get to Google Apps for Business. He can't get to any of the applications he used to do his job because I deleted him. I suspended him in one place, and I took away his account privilege in 15 places. I don't have to log into Box and do it, and into Workday, and into every other app. I go to one place, I turn him off, and I rest assured that he's really turned off. And it's better than that. When I go in here to Google Apps for Business again, here he was, right? This is what I showed you at the beginning. He was automatically set up. If I refresh, he should be automatically taken away, and in active users, I'll just see Jeff. There's Jeff, no Johnny. But it's cooler than that, because Johnny's still here. He's a suspended user. So if I go back and I click, sometimes this guy really wants to be clicked just right. If I look in suspended users, come on, Google, you're better than this. I will see Johnny is a suspended user, and that means his data isn't just nuked. All of his emails aren't gone. All of the stuff that's associated with him is still there. If it was Box, all of his data in Box is still there, waiting for me to assign it to another employee, waiting for me to do discovery on Johnny, on all of his email, if he's been doing something really bad, worse than just wandering around, so that I know I've got the full control. It's not just nuke Johnny and he's done. It's actually granular policy inside each one of those apps to do the right thing, let him go when he needs to be let go. I'm going to switch over as one last thing, and then we'll be on the downhill slope. The other thing that IT can do, I talked about monitoring and reporting. I'm going into an environment that has a lot more data, a lot more information here. We can see a lot of information just at a glance, and we can drill in very deeply. If you want to know where your users are, you can see where they are. If you want to know what apps are in use, maybe you've got marketing coming saying, hey, we need this big piece of budget for you to manage Marketo because it's going to be the hot big ticket and it's going to be something that's really going to drive leads and make us make more money. And then you deploy it and see that it's way down here in your list of apps and it only has 22 people logged in last week. Then you get to talk to marketing and have an educated conversation where you can say, hey man, maybe we'll pay for this, but if your team doesn't use it, what can we do? Do we need training or do we need to get rid of this app, right? You know, in this environment, I've got a lot of engineers on it, so they're tracking all the work that they're doing. Good times. They're really getting a lot of value out of Bugzilla. We've got Salesforce, Office 365, always at the top of the list. We can start seeing where folks log in. I like this one because I was actually giving a demo one time and this kind of thing happened. So I had, there's three users at the south of India. We don't have an office there. I went, should there be three users? It wasn't south of India. It was some random place, like in the middle of Africa. And I said, who's trying to log in from Africa? And so I just did one of these, and I went, oh, that guy. I went to his manager, and I said, is your guy in Africa? And he said, yeah, he's on some crazy safari. I was like, oh, I don't need to fire him. I don't need to suspend that user or take away any of his stuff. It makes me feel a little bit better. That was just random on a demo, right? I didn't like panic in front of everyone, but it's kind of a fun tool. You can immediately see where folks are, make sure the tool's being used, the mix of access here. And of course, this is just one version. I can go into reports and build my own. I can see who's failed when they're trying to log in. I can see where they were when that happened, for example. There's a lot of different security reports that I can pull up to sort of see who's active. Are there any inactive users? Users I think are still valid, that still work for us, but who have stale accounts because they just don't log into certain things anymore, or they're not using a device. I can pull that up easily. I can contact those folks and say, what's going on? Should I turn these off so that they're not a risk to me, so they're not just left open and stale and sitting out there? I can see, like I said, failed logins, which could be somebody that got a hold of Johnny at demo and is trying desperately to get in, but they don't have the multi-factor auth. That's going to be helpful, so I can reset a password if I need to. There's a lot of information here for me in IT to be able to monitor and report, know what's going on, and feel in control, not just of my apps, even though they're out in the world, but of my mobile devices and my employees as well, all consolidated into one place. It's very nicely arranged and easy consolidation so that you don't have to go to an MDM standalone and figure out what's going over there, and then some sort of Active Directory plugin and figure out what's happening over there. It's all one common piece of infrastructure that's all deployed out in the cloud. So I'm going to wrap up here and allow a little bit for questions and a little bit for setting up for our next folks with just three quick points. We talked about provisioning. I hope I showed it to you. All the way from beginning to end, IT has the control, no matter it's on-prem, no matter it's in the cloud or a mobile device. I didn't call a lot of attention to the fact that any of those apps that I saw that I clicked and provided single sign-on, those were all mostly cloud apps, names we're familiar with, right? Box and Concur. If those had been on-prem SharePoint, as an example, that exact same process would have applied for Johnny. Johnny would have been able to just click SharePoint and log in to SharePoint behind the firewall no matter where he was if we deployed it that way, because that same 5-minute cloud connector software that we install that proxies back to Active Directory can also serve as a proxy back to on-prem SharePoint with a fully encrypted tunnel from the device to the proxy, and it only goes to on-prem SharePoint or whichever application IT specifies. It's not full layer 3 network access where you're just saying, here's a VPN, don't mess with me if you get inside my network. You can only get to that application, and I can terminate access to that application as needed. That's an optional thing that we can do as well. I mentioned this up front. If you want to store contractors, other folks in a cloud directory, we proved that we can do that today. We also can proxy back to Active Directory on-prem or LDAP if that's necessary, and we can provide a combination of both of those. It's the most flexible way, and it doesn't require replicating your data out into the cloud. You keep it in AD if that's where you work, right? If that's where all your folks already are and it's protected by your own firewall, keep it there. No need to move it. The last point I'll make is that you got to make sure any solution that you do for this kind of stuff, when it's doing cloud applications, when it's doing mobile, it's got to be available globally because that's kind of where folks are, right? Today I'm in San Diego. I'm going to be in Orlando next week. If I was just only had one node, maybe the United States would work, but if I then went to Spain, I'm going to have a real slow time. I'm going to be hassling with it. It's not going to be great. Make sure it's globally redundant and globally available. Make sure that you have down here at the bottom, SSAE, SOC 2, TrustE, Safe Harbor. These are the things that prove that a vendor doesn't have their fingers in your data, right? These are independent audits that go out and make sure that folks aren't just going through customer data or tweaking or making the wrong kind of changes. They also ensure full multi-tenancy so that one customer's data never is commingled with another. It's really critical to look at. That's kind of the end of my spiel, right? The end of my demonstration. I really wanted to show in real time that it's easy to set up a user. It takes 30 seconds to set them up. It takes 1 second to turn them off. And gone is the time of that high anxiety deprovisioning mode. No matter if the cloud app is something that doesn't know what MFA is or doesn't know what policy is, it's Joe's Crab Shack reward points, I can still put MFA in front of that. I can still secure that app. And I can secure my on-prem apps and my devices all in one situation. So I'll open it up for questions, if there are any, till the end. I'll also be here when David, my colleague, comes up and talks next. I appreciate your time. Thanks very much. Yes? Yeah. Really good question. So in case you couldn't hear, how much effort does it take to set up the integration with a Box or a Salesforce or Google Apps for Business with this management infrastructure? It takes very little, so you have to contact that app provider. So let's say Box was the example. You got to let them know, hey, we have a Box subscription, and we want to use SAML, in their case, for password-free authentication into your system. And they say, no problem. It'll take us about 1 day to set up your account. Box does their magic. And then they provide you essentially not a public key, but they provide you a string that you need to use to redirect so that when someone logs into their account, if they tried to go around the system, and they just went to box.com and said sign in, and they used their username, Box has the smarts on the back end to go, you know what? I'm not going to authenticate you. I'm going to trust an identity provider to do that, and that's going to be Centrify in this case. So it takes about, it could be a day. It's up to the vendor. Sometimes it's much faster than that. They can do it on the fly while you're on the telephone, or you can send an email. Sometimes it takes about a day to turn it around. You plug in the string that they give you into the management system here, and it just works. The key, I'm looking back at the product manager who built a lot of this in the back of the room. It's all tied in nicely so that you spend a little bit of time on the phone, you wait a day, and you're up and running. We want to make sure this is as simple as possible. Part of the advantage of going to the cloud, a lot of our customers, for example, are in the middle of a migration to Office 365. The benefit of doing that is having less orchestration and overhead and just management. We want to make sure we're not adding a lot of hassle to get a simpler solution. So it's a very good question. I saw another hand. Yes. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Gotcha. So the question, these guys are, I imagine, healthcare, you're regulated by HIPAA, right? So they want to know if they have to put multi-factor in front of something and you're accessing from the device, which in this case, I was accessing something here and this was my second factor. We'll look into the rules. The easy answer is there's other things we can do. We can make sure that you had an email that came on another device so that you could use that there. But the harder answer is it's HIPAA. So it has to meet not just the spirit of the law, but the letter. So I want to look through that and make sure that any solution that we would implement works that way. But there's definitely, I got friends from YubiKey that are here today, right? We're talking about, hey, I need a YubiKey on here to squeeze to get to there, whatever it may be, or NFC to my device from that key. These are all things that we're thinking about. Because it's cert-based authentication, there's a lot of flexibility in how you can manage that authentication and how it can work. So I think we'll be able to figure something out for you that'll be in the letter of the law for HIPAA, but it's a good question. We have a lot of customers that are healthcare customers. We have a lot of financial customers on here. So folks for whom these regulations are really important, they're the folks that trust us for this. Centrify has been around like 11 years. David here has been around for almost all of them. And we have customers, we have 25 of the global Fortune 50 as customers. We're really proud of that. When we built this newer solution, we brought it to them and we said, is it going to pass muster for you? So a lot of these things have been built into the background because those are the biggest of the big. They want to make sure it worked for them as well. More questions? No more questions? Well, perfect. Thanks again. If you do think of any questions or you'll see some tie-ins to the other products we talk about or other solutions or best practices, I'll be around. Feel free to come up and ask. And again, I appreciate it. Thanks so much for your time.
Well, thank you for coming today. So my talk is about big data and how big data systems use identity and what the requirements are there. Hopefully this will be a little educational, although I'm not a big data expert. I've been learning, but I know identity and how identity applies to particular problem sets. And we've been learning from a lot of our customers, as they deploy big data environments. But show you an example, and this is a slide I borrowed from one of our customers. She ended up building out this infrastructure at one of her clients where she was working. Big data is hard to understand just because it's designed to analyze a lot of data, hence the name big data. And the whole idea is to take data sets from all over the organization and funnel them into this giant repository so that it can analyze the data set. In many cases, data scientists are doing this work, trying to figure out answers to really hard problems. In this particular case, customer interactions on a website, there's customer profile data, there's customer click-through data. It gets funneled into the Hadoop environment. A lot of other data sets across the bottom might feed into it. And at that point, it gets analyzed, crunched, and then you hope at the end you get some insight into the data. Hopefully you get to answer some questions. I know in the identity space, we'd like to be able to take a lot of information about things that I log into, places that I access, to try to figure out what's normal for me as a consumer authenticating to various sites. or maybe authenticating to things within my environment, so that the whole solution would be able to flag or raise alerts if something that was abnormal was taking place. That's how we would like to apply this kind of solution set to identity management. But what I want to talk about today really is more about what is big data, what it and the challenges that it has, because I'm starting to find a lot of our customers are in the process of setting up Hadoop environments to solve these kinds of problems. And the challenge really is taking it from the development stage and moving it into production. Because developers tend to run things in test environments. They tend to use root accounts. They don't care much about security because they're in isolated environments. Obviously, IT guys really care about security and making it operate correctly within the organization. But to start out, big data is, for all intents and purposes, it's grid-style computing. So there's a lot of computers in a, the goal was to be able to set up data sets that spanned a lot of commodity Linux-based systems. And we've seen Hadoop environments that are start out with like 20 nodes, maybe 40 nodes. I think the most common deployments that I've seen is on the order of a couple hundred nodes. But we do have customers with 4,000 nodes per cluster. I've got other customers that have way larger numbers than that, up in five digits as far as number of nodes within their clusters. But it's different than a database. Clearly, a database has applications that make calls into the database. A database can access the data sets spread across a lot of disks. And so that's what I represent here on the left-hand side is, standard, let's say an Oracle or MySQL environment that sits on top of a lot of large disks. And if you want to protect the data, you just have to protect the one Oracle system or MySQL system, and it has access to the data alone. But in a Hadoop environment, the data is broken up into chunks and spread across all of the computers. And so data is on every single one of the nodes, and the function of searching or analyzing data is spread across every single one of the nodes. So therefore, it gets rather complex or rather fast. So that means that there's inter-server communication that has to take place. There's a lot of service accounts involved in making all of that work that translate to things that we need to worry about to secure. The functions that run on top of the Hadoop environment are various applications. MapReduce is one of the most common as far as the analyzing the data set, reducing the data down. There's SQL style queries into the data set. The blue section processing is all about how do I analyze the data, and there's a lot of different projects within the open source community that process data differently. And this is what a data scientist, his job is to take the problem that you're trying to solve, gather all the data, bring it into the data set, into the Hadoop environment, and then figure out which one of these tools is best to go analyze the data. And once you've analyzed the data, there might be some visualization tools or business intelligence tools on the output side that take it and create graphs and charts and all kinds of things. So it's a constantly evolving environment within the Hadoop environment that just makes it a lot more difficult for us to keep up with it because it is changing on a very, very rapid basis. As the systems move from development into production, this is where there's different people that would need to gain access to the environment. You'll always have IT staff that need to maintain and manage the Linux systems, maintain and manage because they need to be able to install software or start and stop services. But we typically don't need to grant the IT staff rights to access the data set, right? So there's going to be a lot of different actors in play on the various machines. And then obviously most of our customers are concerned with regulatory requirements as they move these things into production. If you think about bringing all of the data set for a typical financial service or retail organization into the Hadoop environment, you've now consolidated data from that used to be set up and secured in various databases. So an attack on one database only yielded part of the data set. Hadoop is like the honeypot for a security attacker. If I was malicious and I wanted to go attack an organization, you'd go look at LinkedIn, find out who's the Hadoop guy, spearfish that particular person, try to figure out his password. Because if I can get into the Hadoop system, usually it has all of the data from every one of the data sources gathered together in the one system. So it becomes a target that, you know, really needs to be protected more so than any other system within the entire IT organization. But it's challenging. So let's explain what some of the challenges are. First of all, this is what a normal Hadoop distribution looks like. And at the very bottom, you see the Linux distribution. Typically, it's sitting on top of Red Hat, Ubuntu, CentOS, something like that within the data center. These machines that it's sitting on, by the way, are not just thin, lightweight blades. I hear from our customers that they're quad processor machines, 12 terabyte hard drives each machine. We know with high-speed gigabit Ethernet, so they're high-end Linux blades, but bare metal. You don't run this on VMware. I can't run it on my laptop. It just consumes too much power. So my test environments actually run out at Amazon. You can run them on hosted environments like Amazon and Azure. The important part is up there on the data access. You'll see that Yarn is sort of the yet another job scheduler. Its goal is to spread out and run the functions across all the computers. The HDFS underneath it is the Hadoop file system. So it sort of sits on top of the Unix Linux file system. It has POSIX ACLs for the files. This is like before the days of Oracle, where you're basically setting up data disk files directly on the hard drive. And the SQL queries are accessing those files directly. And the access controls are still managed by the file system. But now you've got these UI interfaces on the very top, which are the batch jobs, the SQL interfaces, NoSQL interfaces, et cetera. And the user's going to authenticate both at the Linux system to gain access to the HDFS, drop off files, pick up files. He's also going to access the NoSQL and SQL interfaces to do his queries and searches, or maybe to construct his own MapReduce Java applications and deploy that across the cluster. So there's a lot of places where the user needs to authenticate, and we need to control access. I try to represent that by the check marks. As far as the places where I've heard about and know that there is at least user login and access controls available for the user. The other thing is across the right-hand side, I try to indicate by color some of the things that are unique about each of the distributions. So Cloudera and MapR and Hortonworks are the most popular distributions out there for Hadoop. They all are different slightly with respect to some of the user interfaces they provide. So Cloudera Manager, Hortonworks, Umbari, and the MapR control system are sort of their primary Hadoop admin type interfaces. That's where you would go in and you would set up the Hadoop environment, set up the cluster, configure which of these services and jobs are going to run across the environment, which interfaces are available for data ingestion, for pulling data into the system. And then you've got things like the Hue interface on the top left on this side, and that's where most of the time, the end user, the business analyst, would end up accessing the Hadoop environment using the Hue interface. And again, all of these things require users to log in and get their access permissions set up appropriately. I thought this was very applicable because it sort of drives home the real challenge, which is there's the logical access to the data set, which goes through the SQL, NoSQL interfaces. And there is access control set up, and it's a little bit more fine-grained, where ideally, if you've consolidated a lot of data together, you might want to grant somebody access to the rows, in other words, the individual records. But based on PCI requirements, you might, based on a business analyst connecting in, he might not be authorized to see PII data, so you might want to exclude a column. And you can get that kind of fine-grained at the logical access layer. But the data scientists and the people that are manipulating the files, you have to remember the data is actually still in the file system. And in some cases, the user does need to gain access to the file system. And it's not very fine-grained. You either get read or write permissions to those directories and those files. So there are a lot of things that have to be considered when you set up an environment. I've heard some customers starting to set up segregation with respect to volumes. Some of the distributions set that up as well, where they'll let you create volumes, and this volume is dedicated to a particular department. Some of my customers are setting up multiple clusters. It's not uncommon to see several different clusters deployed within the environment in order to segregate data, and then use coarse-grained at the file system layer and fine-grained, for the business analysts. So hopefully that was a little bit of an overview on what the challenges are. I think as far as recommendations, if you haven't had a chance to read it, or if you're just now getting started with Hadoop, a good place to start might be to look at the guidance from Gartner. They've actually published a document on how to protect Hadoop. Because protecting it is rather difficult. And a lot of the people that are doing most of the research here are not typical identity and access management specialists. They're usually data scientists. And it's because this environment has been built by the data scientist in order to solve a lot of problems. And it actually was created without security. And they went back and added security later. So the original version ones of Hadoop didn't have any security inside it. Version 2 went back and added it, and they call that secure mode. And so that's really the next thing to do, is to make sure that, as you look at the Hadoop environment that the data scientists within the organization or developers have set up, is to check and see, did they turn on secure mode? Most likely they haven't, just because that's not their job. Their job was to focus on, how do I solve this business problem? So the first challenge really is put it in secure mode. Okay, secure mode on Hadoop actually requires Kerberos, because that's the reusable authentication that happens from one node to the other. Remember, there's a lot of those applications at the top layer. Those need to communicate to each other. If one node solves a problem, he's got to hand off the results to another node to do its job. And so data moves around this cluster like that, because it's a compute grid. So there's a lot of service accounts. And I've also found a lot of customers that have Active Directory already set up. Because if you don't have, if you go look at the guidance in the open source community, you'll find a lot of discussion about how to use MIT Kerberos and how to generate Kerb5 config files and how to generate key tabs and ship those around the environment. That's one of those things that Active Directory just does automatically, based on the clients that know how to communicate to AD is setting up that Kerberos environment. So it's one of those things that's a lot easier to do if you just simply tie it to AD. Plus, if you think about the end user who needs to log into the system, he most likely already has his Active Directory identity, knows his password. That would be a lot easier for him to just simply reuse that Active Directory credential. And then another thing we had to work with some of the vendors on is this notion of having multiple clusters. And so now all of the distributions at least understand having a cluster prefix or a cluster identity, right? So now there's an ID associated with a given cluster, because, again, when they created it originally, they made assumptions that they didn't have to worry about uniqueness of a service account name for the cluster. So there's a service account called HDFS, and it has to be unique across Active Directory, but originally it was just HDFS at domain. Well, you can only have one of those inside Active Directory, so what happens if you have two clusters? They can't really share the HDFS account, because if I switch to the HDFS user, I could access both clusters. Probably not the right thing to do. So now with this cluster prefix, you can put cluster 1-HDFS, and now keep the two clusters completely separate from who can access those systems. All of the applications at the top layer that I showed earlier, they all need to authenticate a user. Now, they do support Kerberos as a way for a user to authenticate, but in some cases, they present a login screen, and I have to type in a user ID password. And their assumption is that they can go either ask the operating system, that's on the bottom right here is, or left, is PAM and NSS. So we could just simply ask the PAM modules on the Linux system, authenticate david.mcneely@centrify.com. And the PAM module would then go out and communicate to Active Directory and say, is that a good user? Yes, okay, did he type in the right password? Let's validate the password and let the user in. In many cases, You might be able to use Kerberos if you're on a client that knows how to authenticate correctly. So if I'm using PuTTY or if I'm using an ODBC driver that does Kerberos, I can get single sign-on for my Windows workstation or my Mac, as long as everybody's joined to Active Directory. And then there's a lot of these interfaces that don't do those two and only know how to do LDAP. And again, since these are built in the open source community, the projects are all different, so it varies from interface to interface as to which they support. We're starting to find some of these interfaces actually supporting SAML as a way to authenticate to the front web interfaces. So things like the Cloud Era Manager, Cloud Era Navigator supports SAML. Ambari from Hortonworks supports SAML. I'm pretty sure you can get Hue, which is the main interface for an end user, a data scientist. Business analysts, they can use SAML as a way to authenticate. But the identity of the user at the top end of this, remember, has to match the identity of the user down at the HDFS file system level, which is why making sure that whether I authenticate with LDAP or SAML or PAM and NSS, it all needs to be tied back to the same identity provider that keeps up with David.McNeely equals David.McNeely, whether I'm coming in from the top or going sideways. And that can be challenging. And consistency across the cluster is challenging as well. So that means that there's actually one other challenge that I don't have a good picture for, but in the Hadoop environment, if you were a data scientist and you wanted to create your own MapReduce jobs, they're Java applications, you need to create the Java application, you need to load it into the cluster, and then it gets distributed across the cluster by loading it into the HDFS file system. The cluster has this notion of head nodes and data nodes. And so when you go talk to a head node and say, here's a new job, I've got some data, and I've got my MapReduce job, I want to hand off, that head node says, well, you need to contact data nodes 1, 3, and 5 and drop off your data, a piece here and a piece here and a piece here. Well, that means, as a data scientist, I've got to go log on to these data nodes. And that can get quite challenging. Now, they are in the process of moving that work from the user having to go directly to the data nodes to going up to the web interfaces as far as how to submit jobs. But the problem is that I potentially have to be able to connect to and talk to each of the data nodes. And all the data nodes need to be able to know about the end user who submitted a job and the end user who's retrieving the data set, because these jobs run as the user. It's not running as a special account like the quote Oracle account. They're actually running as David McNeely. So that means that identity is important across every single node in the cluster. So that's my point about the first bullet here, is that we need to be able to tie in every node in the cluster into Active Directory in order to make that work right. And then the service accounts are how these computers talk to each other. There's ways to set those up. It's basically Kerberos accounts that need to be created. So inside your Active Directory environment, you're going to see the computers that exist. And this is a small cluster. I only created 4 nodes in this cluster. But if you see at the top there, there's a cloud arrow 1 through 4. Those are the computers that I've set up inside this cluster in an Active Directory environment. I just created an OU called Cloud Era and dropped in the 4 nodes. there's also access controls around users that log into the Cloud Era manager and the other user interfaces that Cloud Era has. And so I created some Active Directory groups to be able to manage which users get specific rights. And then you see all the service accounts. So part of the name inside there is you'll see Cloud Era 1, 2, 3, and 4. So the first group of 4 there says HBase/Cloud Era 1, HBase Cloud Era 2, 3, and 4, et cetera. So every single node has got to have that HBase account, just like they all have to have an HDFS account and an HTTP account and a Hue account. And so as your cluster grows, you're going to be creating more and more of these service accounts. They have to be in Active Directory because they have to have a Kerberos credential. And so there's just some basic management of those kind of service accounts. Most of the tools do a great job of helping you create and manage those accounts, either with the work that Cloud Era has done in their Cloud Era Manager, or Ambari, the new version of Ambari that just came out last month, supports managing these accounts. And MapR reduces theirs to a very small number of accounts. But that's the setup side of it. Now, how do we use it? On the gaining access to the cluster, again, I said the most basic form that you'll find data scientists using, as well as your IT staff, is straight up PuTTY, SSH, directly accessing the system. They need to do that because they're going to be running Hadoop commands or HDFS commands. And there's a classification for administrative rights and end user class commands. So you'll end up needing to control how they, which commands they can execute. But ultimately, they're just doing standard SSH to get to the nodes. And they might only need to access the edge nodes or the ones at the top, the name nodes. But in reality, they potentially need to gain access to any of the nodes in the cluster. There's no reason really to prevent them from doing that if they're a data scientist or a Hadoop admin. Now, if they're a business analyst, you can probably force them to just use a web interface. And then web interfaces, there's, as I said, a lot of them. Most of the business analysts will either access the Hue interface, or they might be using other BI tools that sit on top of Hadoop. and use ODBC connections to get from the BI tools into the Hadoop environment. But again, the identity of the end user, the business analyst, or the data scientist has to transfer from the web front end all the way back to the nodes within the cluster, because again, the jobs run as the user. And these interfaces support either LDAP or SAML-based authentication, so you can configure those for either one you want. The challenge with LDAP tied to Active Directory might end up resulting in the need for an LDAP proxy, just because Active Directory, as you know, is a multi-tree environment. So every Active Directory domain you have equals a tree from an LDAP perspective. These are old school LDAP clients. They only understand a single tree. So they need a base search point, and they don't understand two base search points, one for, you know, the North American domain and one for the EMEA domain. So if you want to be able to let users from multiple domains access your Hadoop environment, you might need to look at an LDAP proxy that can query across Active Directory appropriately to present the data back and authenticate the users. Something I'm finding that's a lot more important in this environment, as well as in the other NoSQL systems, because they're all doing roughly the same thing using standard open source LDAP infrastructures. Again, Gartner, next piece of this really is privilege, and how do I control roles or authorizations to execute specific commands? And Gartner did a good job in describing what was necessary and saying that, you know, you really need to set up roles and rights to be able to control who can gain access. And we also have, you know, the introduction of the IT staff that might be gaining access to these machines and need to control their privileges, because again, this system is going to contain an enormous amount of data across the organization. Just to give you a flavor of the roles that exist, on the right-hand side there is, you know, you'll start out with Linux commands. So obviously an IT guy needs to log into the machine. If you start looking at the processes that are running, the services that are running, you know, with the SBIN service command, you'll find there's an enormous amount of processes running on every single node. Again, back to those service accounts, every service account is there because of an executable that's running. And so you're going to end up with a lot of services that he's going to need to turn on and turn off or make sure that are running on the system. Next up from that is like the HDFS commands. So the data that Hadoop holds is held inside the Hadoop file system, or Hadoop distributed file system. That's what HDFS stands for. And the distributed file system is sitting on top of the standard Unix file system. It uses standard Unix ACLs, but I have to use the Hadoop command, Hadoop space DFS space, and then either LS if I'm trying to do an LS of the directory. So it's not like you can just log into a node and do an LS and see the data. It's not there. You have to do either a Hadoop space DFS space LS command, or sometimes you'll see a HDFS command, sort of a shortcut to get to the other one. And then there's YARN commands that control the execution of jobs, and then there's MapReduce commands. And then you'll find other vendors like Cloudera, MapR, all have their own CLI as well. And they tend to break them up and describe them as commands that the user can execute and other commands that the administrator would execute. So you'll end up needing to think about setting up, you know, a combination of sudo writes as well as restricted shell to sort of come up with this list of commands that the user is authorized to execute while he's logged onto the system. Because you typically don't want to let the user log on and switch to the HDFS account in order to do things, just because then there would be no audit trail as to did David do this work or did someone else. And remember, you have to have a Kerberos credential in order to get to the machine. So it's not like you can go to a password vault and check out the HDFS account and get logged in. That's not going to work. Because the HDFS account is shared amongst all the nodes across the entire cluster. So again, this is designed to tie back very tightly to having a user individually log on as himself to gain access to the system. And just as another example, I put at the very top on the right Cloudera manager roles, Cloudera navigator roles, because again, the web-based applications and the layer at the top, all the applications are trying to build out fine-grained role-based access controls that govern what the user can do once he logs in. So they've already predefined quite a few roles. You just need to put the user into groups that correspond to those role names. So they have the ability to set up a mapping between that role and an Active Directory group, and then that way you just need to go back and manage the Active Directory groups the user is a member of in order to control what his rights are when he logs into the Cloudera Manager or Cloudera Navigator. Same is true of Hortonworks and MapR. They all have the exact same similar functions, which is exactly like every single one of those other applications that are executable. Remember at the very first slide, the, on top of the HDFS system. So, you know, if there's a SQL, NoSQL, the Hive commands, you know, there's a lot of these interfaces, Hive, Search, Impala, the HBase, Storm. All of those are interfaces that control what the user can gain access to at a very fine-grained level. These things all need identity. They do have some projects like the Apache Sentry and Apache Ranger. They're sponsored by different vendors, but they're all in the open source community. They're almost like a policy server, just like we were used to in the identity management space. They look almost exactly like typical policy decision points, policy enforcement points, except that they've got plugins and they were built by the open source community around Hadoop. The end goal really is for them to be able to create enough plugins to go insert themselves into every one of the front ends that is able to access data so that they can provide fine-grained access controls. But it has to match up with the user that has access to the file system underneath, down at the bottom layers. And these systems don't actually authenticate a user, but they need the identity of the user. So they need to know that it's David.McNeely that's trying to access the system. And then they need to know what groups is David a member of, because they can create a role that has a specific set of rights that you can design and customize inside their interface, but they need to understand, how do I put David into that particular role? And that's typically all based on group membership. So whether they pick up a group from a SAML claim, have an enormous number of processes that are running. They have to keep up with those processes and make sure they're operating correctly. So there's a lot of logs that are going to be created on these machines that record who had access to data sets, who was logging in, what tables they were querying, that kind of thing. So just like any other environment, you need to worry about, you know, making sure that the SIEM tools are tied into that environment. Some of the Hadoop vendors are actually building their own SIEM tools, very lightweight versions, but like Cloudera Navigator does a good job of gathering that data up and analyzing it in order to come up and enable you to go back and query and say, okay, David McNeely is one of my data scientists, what did he access? And I can get that information out of the Cloudera Navigator. But you might also use Cloudera Navigator to forward it off to your ArcSight deployment or Splunk and let Splunk do that work. That gives you, you know, some portion of the data that explains David accessing data sets inside Hadoop, but it's not going to tell you what the IT staff or your Hadoop admins did at the CLI level. For that, you're going to need session monitoring. Privileged session monitoring is a tool set that is designed to record either SSH or RDP connections. Into Active Directory. And if they're tied to Active Directory, then at that point you can use AD for your identity for users and groups. That's represented by PAM and NSS. Kerberos and GSS API need to be running on every one of the nodes. So there's a KERB5 configuration file that's part of that. If you have a tool that does this Active Directory client work that ties into Active Directory, typically that tool maintains and manages your KERB5 config file so that if a domain controller goes offline, no problem, it dynamically adjusts itself, and as new domain controllers come online, it will find those as well. And then you just need to go back to the Cloudera Manager and Ambari environments and just tell them that the AD client tool is managing the KERB5 config so that it's not a static file. It's a lot like a DNS. You need it to be completely automatic. And then you might find sudo and LDAP proxies that are down in this 80 client at the operating system level that are tying it back into the operating system, and then that provides identity back up the stack. So then as we go up, the Hadoop core like HDFS, MapReduce, Yarn, they're all going to take advantage of that identity data that came from the Active Directory client. And then the web interfaces at the top, most of the time, those are going to be tied into LDAP. But again, they need to understand the exact same notion. So usually it's LDAP straight to Active Directory. And then the question is, how do you get there? Do you use LDAP on your Active Directory and turn on LDAP-S and set up PKI certificates? Or do you use an LDAP proxy in order to get from the front end back to the Active Directory? And that really is a question based on your Active Directory environment, if you have multiple domains or not. So far, is that making sense? So just a little bit about what Centrify has done in this environment. A commercial from your sponsor. Tried to not to make too much of that product pitch up front, but we have been working with a lot of customers. Where I find most of our engagements are with the large financial institutions, as well as the intelligence community within the US government, have some extremely large Hadoop environments. But I'm starting to find this is coming up very often. And usually, the IT staff that maintain and manage the data center hear about it long after the data scientists have been playing around with it and have their 20, 30, 40 nodes up and running in their test environments. They can usually get by and set that up without IT support. They'll do that themselves, or they might have been playing around on Amazon. But once they figured it out, then at that point, they usually bring it over to IT and say, can you help me get this up and running? And I want to integrate it into the website because we're going to analyze click-through traffic and we're going to help the marketing guys figure out how to do a better job of selling our product or whatever the problem space was they're looking at. And at that point, the IT guys are like, okay, wait, now we can't run this on VMs. We want to go set up real machines. How many racks of real machines do I need? And how do I set up access controls and all of that kind of stuff? So that's really where we've gotten involved in these projects as they move to production. And a lot of times they start out with as I said, the development is usually like 10 to 20 nodes. Production usually starts out thinking it's going to be a couple hundred nodes, but then I've had the customers come back to me and say, no, it's going to be more like several thousand nodes in the cluster. It really depends on how big the data set is. And so we've also been working with Cloudera, Hortonworks, and MapR because this is an ongoing evolution. They're still building these products, right? And Ranger and Sentry are trying to do fine-grained access control, but they're still in development. This is rapidly evolving. These vendors tend to follow the open source, but that open source environment changes every few months. And so it's one of those things where we're starting to find there's a lot of cross-training that needed to happen, right? We needed to sort of understand what is this Hadoop thing, because it tends to be taking over, the relational database space within the environment and getting a lot of attention. Yet they don't know quite as much about identity services. These are a lot of companies that have more data scientists. They don't really have that many people that do security or do identity. They sort of trust the operating system as the way they've been doing it in the past. So there's a lot of work we've been doing to cross-educate their team as well as educate my team. But all of our customers have been up and running and have this environment set up. It's really a matter of taking the Centrify agent and installing it on every single node within the cluster. And that provides the identity data from Active Directory. And we've got a lot of tools to help make that easier as far as the deployment. That join of Active Directory creates the computer accounts. So that's something that's completely automatic. We enforce group policies to make sure the policies are common and standardized across the entire cluster. Things like the IP tables, firewall, or the OpenSSH config settings, those are easy things to make sure are consistent across the cluster. And then creation of service accounts. all of this depends on Kerberos to work correctly. And we do find that as Cloudera Manager and Ambari have added better support for creating the service accounts, that they're doing a pretty good job of managing that and keeping up with the service accounts. These service accounts just simply need Kerberos to be working correctly underneath them. And that's really what the Centrify agent's responsible for. That actually translates to giving the user a single sign-on as long as he's using a client, either PuTTY or the ODBC drivers for his BI tools. Those things know how to use Kerberos. It's just a matter of making sure that Kerberos works correctly on every single endpoint, the workstation and the servers. And then role-based privilege management is sort of our version of sudo that allows us to go back and set up the roles and rights for the IT staff as they're accessing the machines. And those can be fine-tuned and customized, you know, to support the various roles of IT staff or Hadoop admins that you may have within your environment. Just a matter of defining exactly which commands you want to allow them to execute and or give them a restricted shell that says you're allowed to execute these specific commands independent of the others on the system. And then we do have the session monitoring that's designed as a video camera recording. That's one of those things that a lot of the jump box type deployments tend to provide, which I sort of liken to putting a video camera on the front door of the house. That's great, you get everybody that came through the front door, but what about your kid that climbed in a window or what happened inside the house? You don't get quite as much visibility. So we tend to put that agent on every single system so that we get very fine-grained analysis of exactly what happened on the computers. Because it can feel kind of delicate when you're running a Hadoop environment. I know within the four nodes that I've got, and it's not a big environment, and I pause them on Amazon when I'm not using them, just to reduce the bill that I have to expense. But those machines, I've got one that tends to run a lot more services, and he's got some problems. And so the, you know, it never reports a green dot that says he's in perfect condition. It's always looks a little bit different. But that's just because the configuration management and trying to manage these can be rather difficult. The video camera recording always tells me exactly who accessed the machine and what happened, what config changes happened to the system, and that's really important to understand. To keeping the Hadoop infrastructure alive. And then functionality. We offer the server suite in a couple of different versions. So we've got standard edition is the basic that most people would need in order to get started. That's going to provide the basic Active Directory integration, the group and identity-based information back up to the cluster, and it will also provide the privilege management. Although I do find most of our larger deployments have been going with Enterprise Edition in order to get that video camera audit recording, the session monitoring, just because, again, it's an extremely valuable data set that's being loaded into this environment. And these customers are investing an enormous amount of money and time into creating the Hadoop environments to get it to translate to business value at the end of the day, and obviously want to protect that as much as they possibly can. We do have a new privileged service that adds to that the capability for vaulting passwords and enabling people to check out root accounts and other accounts like maybe the Oracle account or the HDFS password if you really needed it for those situations where IT where it warrants that. And it also provides remote access. So I found it really cool. I used the identity service that Chris showed earlier as a way to get to my Hadoop environment that's running at Amazon, because I've set it up so that it doesn't have any elastic IP addresses, and from the security group perspective, the firewall is fully up. There's no inbound ports available. Yet I can still go to that console and the portal, and I can still click on the Hue interface or the Cloud Area Manager and get to my cluster. But the only way I'm getting there is through that identity provider based on the application gateway functionality. And then I'll use this product as a way to control, you know, the Kerberos environment inside that ADFS or Amazon's AWS environment. So with that, all the slides I had prepared, and I didn't really spin up my server, so I don't really have a demonstration available at this point, but certainly we can schedule that and I can show that to you, you know, one-on-one if you have any further questions. But with that, thank you for your time, and I'll open it up for questions if you have any. So let me start. How many people are, do you know if you have a Hadoop in your environment? Are you running Hadoop today? A couple of you? Is it in development or production? Production, great. Well, thank you for your time, and we'll be here if you have any other questions.
My name is Brad Zehring. I'm from Centrify Corporation. I'd like to thank all of you for taking the time out of your busy day here at the conference and spending a few minutes with me. I think I'm the last presentation of the day. I'd make a crack about they save the best for last, but you know that's not true, so I won't say that. I'm here to talk about some really crazy idea, which is privileged identity management for the modern enterprise. So let's define privileged identity management, modern enterprise, and the solution that we ended up with. I'm going to try to do all of that in 5 or 10 minutes, then spend a little bit of time looking at the deployment architecture of the solution, as well as the security and just the general architecture of the product itself. And we'll have plenty of time for Q&A if anybody's interested in sticking around for a few minutes and asking questions about it, because this is a fairly new kind of product. And we did not arrive at building this thing easily. It was a year, 2 years of concerted effort in thinking about what we wanted to deliver to market to address some gaps in our overall identity management product portfolio. It led us down a path to release what we think is the first fully functional shared account password management system delivered as a cloud service, and how we ended up doing it and why. Everything starts with customer requirements. Well, that's not entirely true. There are also business requirements as well. But for me as a product manager, the thing I have to look at is customer requirements and figure out how to, you know, enable solutions to that in software. So what did we start with? We started with about 10 years of an existing business in identity management, a rich portfolio of customers, and hundreds or thousands of inquiries and requests about some things that the products we shipped did not do. And customers wanted solution for some problems that we couldn't solve. So we had a lot of customers to talk to. We found out that they were doing some interesting things. The general trends that we identified over the course of this discovery process were that everything is everywhere now, pretty much. Compute resources, network resources, most people, unless you're a cloud service startup, in which case you might have literally everything in infrastructure as a service, you have a traditional on-premises data center, which is 99% of the companies in existence today, or organizations, not just businesses. You might have these things co-located, managed service provider, whatever. Mergers and acquisitions are always an issue, of course. You'll have different infrastructure coming into your organization, or you're merging into another organization with your infrastructure. You have partnerships. They could be business partnerships or technical partnerships, development partnerships, whatever, where you have the need to access the same equipment that an entirely different organization also needs to access, something that's out of your control, outside of your security and organizational boundaries. You might have it, or some part of it, I should say, deployed in infrastructure as a service. When I started looking at Amazon Web Services several years ago, I did what everybody at Symantec did at the time. We whipped out our credit card and bought a couple of servers and did that. And then eventually the finances group started looking at all the receipts that everybody was submitting for reimbursement and discovered we had some ungodly, like 500 different departmental purchases in AWS. But AWS is now, I think, the world's largest provider of infrastructure as a service. Microsoft Azure is the world's second largest provider of infrastructure as a service. And a lot of us are using those services not just for departmental reasons, but also for major mainstream IT activities, especially in development operations prior to major deployment. And all of this stuff comes in different form factors as well. We all know about server virtualization, the new container technology, Docker, and all that stuff that's coming out now, and the Microsoft stuff. Rack mount is great, not a problem there, but now we also see desktop, laptop, and mobile form factors as well, and you can almost think of cloud services as another kind of form factor for the services we consume in our IT department and, in, to some extent, services that we have to manage. So that's the infrastructure. They're not the only thing that's distributed. The people that you manage, the people that you work with, you yourselves are not necessarily sitting in the data center. Probably not. If you're an FTE, you could be at home, you could be mobile, you could be In the office, you could be at some random location someplace and you need to access infrastructure. If you're outsourced, or if you work with an outsourced team, they are somewhere. You probably don't know where they are, but they're somewhere out there in the world accessing your infrastructure. Again, you have the partner scenarios for development and IT. You need to share access to your infrastructure with another organization that, again, doesn't fall within your security and organizational boundaries. And you also have the umbrellaed scenario, either an MMA, perhaps, or some kind of joint program management with another organization. So all of these people, many of whom are not under your control, don't work for you, don't work for your same organization, need access to your infrastructure for management reasons. So there were some key conclusions that we arrived at. The first line is pretty much it. Everyone is anywhere, and they all need to get into your stuff. Anybody disagree with that? It's pretty much the trend that we see today. And all your stuff is everywhere, and they all need to do it securely. This is not how it used to be, but this is increasingly what we see at Centrify among all our customers. And it's interesting, too, because we have a very strong presence in financial services and in government. Obviously, different governments are going to adopt different cloud-based technologies at a different pace. But there are major components of the U.S. government that are absolutely dedicated to this, as well as other governmental organizations around the world that we work with, especially in EMEA. So what does this mean for us from a product development perspective? It means that things have changed. This is today the modern enterprise. Privileged users are distributed, both physically and topologically, relative to the network and compute resources that they need to manage. The compute resources themselves, the network resources, are now distributed in ways that 20 years ago, 30 years ago, we couldn't possibly, well, we imagined. Actually, we did imagine because the internet is, you know, that old, but now we're seeing it in day-to-day operational life where this stuff and this stuff, somehow all these people have to manage everything out there. What do? We also have multiple sources of identity. Centrify's first product was just a simple AD bridge. Installed as a client on a Red Hat. Was Red Hat around then? Somebody was around, the Linux servers. And connected that server to Active Directory as if it was a Windows machine. So that was 11 years ago, the company started with that. What we see today is that organizations, because of all this different kind of activity, M&A activity, partnerships, just organic growth, most organizations have multiple sources of identity. A lot of them key off of Active Directory. Active Directory sort of won the directory service battles over the last 15 years, and there are good reasons why they did. But a lot of organizations now find themselves in a position where they need to authenticate users against more than one identity store. Not at the same time, obviously, but they might have partners, they might have vendors, they might have resellers, they might have development partners, whatever. These resources need to authenticate against their canonical source of identity, whatever that happens to be. My Active Directory, your Active Directory, your LDAP server, whatever it is. We need to get the right people authenticated against the right source. And there are going to be more than one of those in a lot of organizational scenarios today, vis-a-vis IT system management. And obviously, different relationships between these organizations. So that's what we're looking at today from Centrify's perspective when we started out to build this product and service. So what should we build? We needed something that could address, at a minimum, all of these requirements. We need to authenticate and authorize IT system admins, really any user with privileges to do something to a box, not just run an application, but actually physically do something to change a configuration, whatever IT system admins do. We had to build it in a way so that the system didn't care where they were. It could be anywhere in the world. As long as they could connect to a public network, they could get access to the infrastructure that they needed to manage. We needed to use the correct authentication source for that particular user, and it could be any one of many different authentication sources for a particular organization. We needed to be able to store and share and manage shared account passwords. That was where we started, was filling a gap in our product portfolio to address the case where you actually have a root password. You need the actual root password to that server. Server goes down in single user mode. For whatever reason, you can't spin up a virtualized instance of the same server. You actually need to go reboot that particular server right there. So what do? To secure the root account passwords in that case. We also wanted to do integrations. We've done a lot in extending open source products and services in the industry with some of the Centrify products over the past decade. We're very interested in working with some of the other, especially in the IT space, with some of the other service providers who you're using today inside your environment to do lots of different things, whether it's trouble ticket, whether it's workflow, whatever it is. We think it made a lot of sense for us to build a product that was capable of fast, reliable integration with those other products as well, regardless of whether they were on-premises or delivered as a cloud service. So we did the right thing. We think it was the right thing. We built a privileged identity management service in the cloud for what we think is the modern enterprise, or at least where we think the trends are headed. So the general idea is we have a core piece of code, a bunch of core services that expose secure RESTful APIs. It's really simple. This is tomb architecture. We'll get into some better stuff than this in a second. But the general idea is that we have a cloud service, the core services, managing storage, managing all this other stuff. In fact, let me get to that slide. So all this stuff, a cloud-based directory, the authentication engine, which connects to other identity stores, the multi-factor authentication, a policy engine built in for role-based access control and management, the reporting engine, and the secure data storage. All of this is basically a layer of services that expose secure RESTful APIs. We build our products and services on top of this platform. So we built the platform first. We've been working on this for 4 years. We've had one product sitting on top of this in the marketplace for 2.5 years. That's our SSO in the cloud solution, right? Centrify Identity Service. But when we built Privilege Service, we took advantage of all of this stuff that they'd already built. The product that I manage is literally built out of a series of RESTful API calls. These are documented, or will be, in customer-facing form a little bit later this year. And getting back to the integration point, well, I'll get into that in a second. There's some good stuff there. Let's take a look at the functionality that we wanted to bring to market. That piece on the right-hand side over there, a checkout account passwords, login to shared accounts, and attribute accounts to the individual. Those are basically the use cases we wanted to address with this product. Very straightforward, very basic shared account password management system. We also wanted to do a couple of other things. Obviously, we needed some kind of session monitoring so that we could audit and track what people were doing in those privilege management sessions. This is very straightforward. It's a gateway-based auditing component in the solution. Now, one in the upper right's a little bit more interesting. Your stuff is everywhere. The people who need to access it are anywhere. So from a remote access perspective, it made enormous sense for us to build a solution in the cloud because that was the most natural way for us to provide access to infrastructure regardless of its physical or topological location and regardless of where the end users are, or the privileged users in this case. So the shared account password management system is pretty much what you'd expect. It does a couple of simple things. If you need to check out a root password securely from a vault in the cloud, you can. if you want to launch a remote session using a shared account without disclosing that password to the user, you can do that as well. And I'll show you a diagram in a minute that shows that architect. Well, actually, there's kind of a diagram here. We'll get into that in a minute. A secure remote access. We want to make sure that users are authenticated to your identity store, if that's what you want to do, whether it's LDAP or Active Directory. So all of their authorization within the privilege service that we provide is based on their user identity and or their Active Directory security group memberships, right? So all of that stuff that you do at the front end with your provisioning systems in terms of who's who and what they should have access to, we'll inherit all of that, we'll look at it, we'll leverage all of that stuff in terms of our own rule-based access control for who can get to what server. And the audit and session monitoring, this is gateway-based. So any session, whether it's SSH or RDP, Unix, Linux, network device, Windows, whatever it is, we're going to take a full fidelity video recording of exactly what happened in that session. And of course, within the service itself in the cloud, we're going to keep track of, you know, who logged into what. This is the basic diagram. I apologize for it not being red. This being a Centrify presentation, this should have been done in red, but I did it in blue. Visio defaults. So over here, in the middle of the left, we have an IT system admin. They connect from their browser, Chrome, IE, Firefox, whatever, over 443 to the Centrify cloud, where privilege service sits. Privilege service has that core platform that it uses with reporting services and the secure data storage and all that good stuff. Sitting over here on your premises in your data center, on a Windows server, there's another Windows service that you've installed. It's our proxy. We call it the Cloud Connector. It has a number of different services. It'll connect to your Active Directory instance, read-only. It'll provide auditing services for all the sessions that your users are launching and performing activity through. And it actually provides the remote session service going from the jump box to the individual devices, either on-premises or in the cloud. It's pretty straightforward. The service, that Cloud Connector proxy, is a client to the cloud. So the client, the Cloud Connector, always initiates the conversation to start off with. Basically, it goes through 443, goes up to the cloud service, identifies itself via mutually authenticated certificates. It says, hi, I'm kibble.centrify.com. I'm Cloud Connector, I'm supposed to get to this tenant. At that point, basically, the proxy is setting up a long pole connection, or the equivalent of a long pole, so that either side from that point forward can initiate communication through that channel. The proxy can read from Active Directory. So when brad.zehring@centrify.com logs into privilege service knows who I am, it knows what tenant I belong to, it goes ahead and puts a query into the Cloud Connector and says, please authenticate this user with these credentials against your Active Directory instance. So the authentication when I actually log into the system is going back into your canonical identity source. We're actually asking your identity source for the authentication, right? So if that comes back and says, yes, that is indeed Brad's password, whatever, the service may at that point in time also prompt me for a second factor of authentication, depending upon how you've configured it. So I'll get an SMS message on my phone. I could use the mobile client here that we provide people to authenticate. I could get an email. It could be a security question. I think there's a half a dozen different methodologies that you can expose to your end users. And in this case, because these are privileged users, you do, in fact, probably want to set up multi-factor authentication for them and not just go with passwords. So once the user's authenticated, they now have the ability to connect to any of the infrastructure in the cloud, on premises, that you, through role-based access controls, have given them permissions to work with. could be Windows servers, Linux servers. We support all the same 420 in the current version. Historically, with stuff we're still supporting, it's over 450 different Unix, Linux, and Windows platforms right now. So all that stuff supported, in addition to five network operating systems. So there's Cisco IOX, Nexus, Juniper JunOS, NHP ProCurve, and Comware. Right, those are the five. So any of those classes of devices are supported right now with the product that we just started shipping about 6 weeks ago. So that's what we built. We built it on top of Microsoft Azure. There were a couple of reasons that we did this. One, Azure is FedRAMP certified. We do a lot of business with national governments, including the US government. It was very important to us and to our customers to be on a platform that had the appropriate certifications for these various governmental organizations to even be able to use, right? So we chose Azure because they're FedRAMP certified. They also have tremendous worldwide coverage for us to provide to our customers. We're in 12 right now. I think we just opened our 12th data center, a geographic location in Azure around the world. So we're located in every geographic region, sitting in the Azure data centers in those particular regions. One of the things we got a chance to do when we built this product was design security into the product as we were building it. So there's nothing legacy about this product in the sense of we're using old code or we inherited code. This product was built by the same architectural team that built Centrify Server Suite with the decade of experience that they had building and delivering that product to market, as well as their prior experiences at different other locations. The first thing we do when we add something new to the product is design the security architecture of the functionality that we want to bring to market. As a product manager, for me, that's fantastic. We have a very rigorous internal development process for this. And line to take a look and see if we've introduced accidentally anything that could constitute a security concern for us. The service is highly scalable for a couple of reasons. The Azure infrastructure obviously scales well from a global perspective, but we designed this with something that we call pods. And each pod is a set of compute resources sitting in Azure. It has its own self-contained security boundary. And the pod itself is comprised of a number of different virtualized servers performing very specific tasks. So one set of servers may be responsible for maintaining the data cache for transactional processing in the context of what the service is doing. Another set of resources or servers is responsible for dealing with storage to and from Azure tables and blob storage. That's the general idea. So these pods are scalable internally. We can add compute and do add compute resources on demand as customers scale out. but it also works very, very well from an HA and DR perspective as well. And speaking of that, there are three questions that customers always ask me when I tell them that we're delivering this as a cloud service. The first thing they want to know is, are you nuts? That's a separate question. We take that offline. We'll get back to that. Why should I trust you with my data? And what happens when your cloud service goes down? Two entirely reasonable questions. I'm not going to launch into the reasons why Centrify believes you should trust us with your data in this presentation. I'm happy to do that separately, and we have some excellent literature on that. I will say this about it. We understand the reluctance that people have to put what they consider to be the crown jewels of the IT organization, the passwords for their servers, into a cloud storage environment. We've worked very hard to provide an infrastructure and a service where we believe that those passwords are at least as secure as anything in the most modern corporate or organizational data center in the world today. And we have good reasons to believe that. But having said that, I think this will be, well, we're leading here. We're on the leading edge of this. We're the first people to do this. So the two questions I get are, have you lost your minds? And can I please see how you've done this? Even the customers and prospects who have told us flat out, we will never put our passwords in the cloud. We will never trust this kind of information to a cloud service provider. The second thing they say is, can I please see it? Can you please bring it on site? Can you please demonstrate it for us? Can you please show us what's going on? These are not irreconcilable views. This is entirely reasonable. The first and most immediate reaction is, there's no way I'm ever going to do this. The second reaction is, that's actually pretty interesting. Let me take a look at it. So across the spectrum, what I'm seeing right now, and having talked to literally hundreds of customers at this point in time, it's kind of a bell curve, really is. We're seeing some people who are absolutely anxious to get started with it right away. We're seeing this group right here, right, where there's, let's talk. We're not entirely convinced that we're going to do this. And there are people on this side who, for good reasons, will probably never adopt anything like this from a security and architecture perspective. One of the things that was important to us was to make sure that we had the appropriate certifications in place for two reasons. One, customers expect this, and two, it forced us to do things differently and in a good way. So we were one of the first vendors in this particular market to achieve SOC 2 compliance, Security Operations Center 2 compliance. Most of you, I'm sure, are familiar with what this is. I won't go into the details. As well as trustee and safe harbor certification as well. By the way, on the SOC stuff, I think an annual audit is what's required. We do it quarterly. We have our outside auditing firm comes in and performs a new audit against our operations, processes, management, and historical operational data every quarter. And we make that available to any customer or prospect who's interested in seeing the actual audit report. One of the other concerns that people have when you talk about moving things like their server passwords into a cloud solution is, how do I achieve the level of compute and data segregation that my organization requires me to achieve, or that I require the organization to achieve? So we have a number of different options. By default, everything in Azure basically uses virtualized data isolation, and Azure can, we can certainly talk about that for hours in terms of how they do that. But we also have some additional hosting options available for people who need more. So we can apply actual compute isolation, so the compute resources are physically separate from the rest of the Azure infrastructure. We can do the same thing for data storage isolation. So rather than using the multi-tenant architecture that in Azure that we sit on top of, they offer additional options that we can provide to our customers in terms of actually providing physical and network segmented isolation both for data and compute resources depending upon what people need. So that is one of the things that our larger customers are very, very interested in. Okay, before I get into the sales pitch, does anybody have any questions? Would you like to know anything about what we did this? You know, does it make sense? Am I? Yeah, go ahead. Somewhere else? So the answer is if that master key, the master key is also backed up. So we use, how do I say this? One of the things that SOC 2 requires us to do, which is really cool, is use multiple entirely physically, organizationally separate vendors in order to secure and manage stuff. So the tools that we use to actually manage our pods in Azure reside in AWS. And that's actually where we keep the key. So all of that has its own separate architecture and backup and restore and HA and DR. It's provided by AWS, independent of Azure. So the short answer is if AWS ever goes completely down, which by the way it has, right? Shame on them, but it has. That could absolutely interfere with the runtime operations of the system. Yes, that's true. We don't anticipate that being a big problem going forward. But things break. I will say this. One of the first things that we started working on when we launched this project was provide an escrow service, right? There were two things that the people came to us and said, okay, look, we want to be able to maintain our passwords on premises, if you can figure out a way to do that. But even more than that, we need a way to provide some kind of escrow, right, to a separate site or a separate vendor or a separate partner, whatever, where we can still get access to that stuff even if the cloud service goes down. So we're rolling that out before the end of this calendar year. We'll have probably both options available before the end of this, before December. Question? So this is a very good question. The answer is absolutely yes. We have the keys at Centrify to be able to look at any customer data in the cloud. Now ask me the next question, which is, can I do that? I can't. I have no physical way to ever get to those keys or look at that data. Can Microsoft? No, because Microsoft doesn't have the keys and all the data between the various compute resources, every virtualized server that we stand up, we issue our own certificates for them. So the communication from one server to another server, even inside the compute pods that we were talking about earlier, that's all through mutually authenticated certificates that we're issuing off of our VeriSign certificate. So even in the network traffic internal to Azure, they can't look at anything. And they certainly don't have the keys to look at the data. So put the Azure piece aside. Our cloud operations team, which falls under the SOC 2 compliance guidelines, are the only people at Centrify that can look at customer data. Under the SOC 2 processes, they cannot look at it unless you ask us to. Why would you ever ask us to look at your data for troubleshooting purposes? For basically, that's it. If something happens in the system and you're not sure why it happened, whether it was through inputting a wrong DNS address or wrong DNS name or some configuration problem, you may want to give the cloud operations team at Centrify the ability to look at data, both in transit and data in storage, to see exactly what's going on and help troubleshoot the problem. But all of this is done under SOC 2 guidelines. So there are, I think, 5 people at Centrify that have the ability to do this, and it's just the cloud operations team. Long answer, but I assume there's a follow-up. So the answer is no. We don't have agents sitting on the clients, for example, to... let me see if I've got the question right. Once we take a password, I'm Brad, I'm an IT admin. I say, give me the root password to that Red Hat server. We're going to decrypt that into plain text within the pod itself on Azure. That information will be transmitted over, again, mutually authenticated, certificate-based, encryption, blah, 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 over the wire to the cloud connector on premises. The cloud connector will then transmit that over whatever it needs to me, which would typically be 443, unless, actually, you can't configure for anything else. Well, you can, you just can't configure it for standard HTTP. Just going to communicate that to me over an HTTPS wire into my browser, where I get a chance to either display it or just copy it to the clipboard without displaying it. So the answer is yes, stuff is transmitted as plain text over an encrypted channel from the cloud back to the consuming user or the consuming device. If, for example, we're using that password to log a user onto a system using a shared account. You mean at the cloud connector?
Yeah, I assume the cloud connector is something on premise. The client's going to own it, going to configure it. Maybe they have a tertiary key,
mm-hmm.
a password, so when it's given to the cloud is actually re-encrypting something
you've
already encrypted.
So the answer is we could do that, absolutely. That's something that we might. Without walking through the use cases here, this was something that we considered. We decided not to do that. We're not... we're not sure that the... And we could be wrong about this. We've been wrong about other stuff. I've been wrong about other stuff. We're not convinced yet that the additional security provided by this is necessarily worth the operational risk in terms of introducing another key into the infrastructure there. So very reasonable minds disagree quite strongly on this kind of an issue. But to date, we haven't seen that it gives us the benefit versus the operational risk that we're seeing with that. One of the things that we wanted to do delivering this as a cloud service is make it as seamless as possible. So we wanted to, seamless, boy, that's a stupid word, make it as simple as possible. So we wanted to provide anything that's transmitted to the clear, obviously over encrypted channels, anything that has to do with machine communication is basically either over IPsec or something that's effectively analogous to that. Sure. Mm-hmm. Well, they can't the way the process is actually seen, they can't get to that password. That password is that key, if you will, is maintained under control in its own system. They can't actually get to the key. They could use the key, but they have no knowledge of what the key is themselves, if that makes sense. So again, that's part of the SOC 2 process, and we can show you what that looks like in the audit report, if that helps. Question? I knew ultimately this would devolve into an encryption key discussion. Right.
So essentially, you're doing admin by proxy. So you're proxying the data by using the key, acting on his behalf to access the data.
In a sense, yeah.
So in our case, what we did we're a credit card company, so we build software. We put it in Azure. Operational data versus long-term data or code data, you have two different things.
Yeah, PCI, absolutely, yeah.
PCI compliant, yeah.
DSS compliant, sure.
So, in your case, if my senior valid were to be authenticated or authorized through Centrify, it would fail because someone else can act on behalf of our admin or proxying into just to get operational like logs or system information. So, I think if you encrypt the data before you even get to your Centrify pods, and the key you have is only for traditional logs, the data itself, I think that could be a viable solution in the industry. But I think it will make me very nervous if we know, even today, we have three for the entire organization, all we need to be in the same room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nuclear codes, yeah. Yeah.
So nuclear launch. That even after multiple layers of security. Right? So
we have enough risk trusting our own staff to have access to the master key, let alone a vendor. So we wouldn't put our master key in someone else's hands if they had any functional way to see it. We would put it in their hands if we knew that we held the other key, meaning they could never see its contents because we have to initiate the final step.
Sure, split keys, yeah. All of this is possible over time. As to PCI DSS, yes, the data has to be encrypted in transit and at rest, always, or at least obfuscated, right, if it's written so it's literally blanked out in case of an audit database. So a simple example, in the audit piece where we do the session monitor capture, on Unix and Linux systems, we're basically looking at the standard in and standard out to reconstruct what in effect looks like a video capture. That log has controls to strip out anything that meets a certain pattern. So question mark, question mark, question mark, question mark, dash, whatever, right? For exactly those reasons. That was one of the things that we had to do when we built the auditing solution was make it possible to strip out, right, the stuff that people were entering or capturing as a result of reading a file or whatever it was, so that the auditors, whether it's a supervisor or separate security auditing team, does not have access to that data as well. So that's something we're very interested in. Yeah. Can I get your contact info before you take off here? Because if you're interested, I'd like to have a dialogue later on with you about that. You too. we're not, this is new stuff. we're sort of breaking ground here, and we're pretty comfortable with what we've done so far, but depending upon what customer requirements are, we'll make some changes and some additions to it. I will say this, we have no intention of making this an on-premises product. This particular solution and Centrify's response to secure remote access, shared account password management, I just don't see us ever making this on-premises. There's too much infrastructure, too much that we take advantage of from the cloud service perspective.
I love all the infrastructure. I love the
You know, that's interesting. That's actually not something that's covered in our security white paper. We have a 18-page white paper sitting up on the website right now that you can download that goes into some detail on a number of these topics, but we don't go into that issue. We don't go into that specific topic in terms of what we're doing to make sure that no one else can read your identity information. We don't actually store passwords for users. In privilege service. All of that stuff is, you're feeding through your credentials. When you log on, those credentials are going back to whatever the LDAP store, Active Directory, or the Centrify Cloud Directory service, wherever. Actually, we could store your password if you put it in the Centrify Cloud Directory service. But if it's AD or LDAP, we're not storing anything. We're just passing those credentials through and saying, hey, you authenticate these people and tell us yay or nay. But there are some cases in another part of the product, which is called Identity Service, which basically enables single sign-on from one portal to cloud applications. It does a number of other things as well by offering the same kind of single sign-on to on-premises applications through your browser. But there are some cases where if you're not using SAML tokens, for example, you'd actually have to store the password someplace, right, to feed it back in, like LastPass or something, or Norton Identity Safe, whatever you're using. Same general idea. We do not in the security paper describe that. That's a good catch. I don't know how we do it. I don't know what's special about that per se, other than in terms of using the same key that we use for the rest of the data. I don't know if the identity service team is doing something different in that regard. So although I can't say for sure here exactly what it is, but we'll add that to the white paper. That's been a very common response so far, especially the secure remote access piece without VPN. That's been, surprisingly to us anyway, that's been the most interesting thing to a lot of people we talk to. Part because it's so granular, right? You can grant access to that person sitting in an outsourced IT team or your own IT team, access to that account on that particular server or just to that particular server using their own credentials, right? This whole remote connectivity thing, it extends beyond just using shared accounts. You can actually configure the server or configure the user's permissions to be able to log in remotely using their own credentials. So if you've got, for example, a bunch of Windows servers that are connected to AD, if you're using Centrify Server Suite to connect those Linux and Unix servers to AD, you can actually use CPS as a remote access service and basically have people continue to log in as themselves. And they're still authenticated through Centrify or through Windows back to the Active Directory instance on-premise. So we'll see. But that's been a very... surprisingly, a thing of surprisingly high interest to us. In fact, one of the teams that we're working with right now is a bank, North American Bank. They don't want to use CPS for anything else. They don't want any of the shared account password management stuff. They're not comfortable with that yet. But just the remote access service for people to use their own credentials to log into particular servers and have all of that audited and tracked, they're thinking seriously about, you know, deploying that before the end of the calendar year. So we'll see. Pretty cool stuff. Any other questions about Centrify as a company? Can I do the sales pitch real quick? Please say yes. Okay. It's a great company. I've been working in this business now since 1984. In some way, shape, or form in computing technology. I've worked at a variety of different companies. I've done a lot of different stuff. This is the best company I've ever worked for in my computing science career. Centrify unifies identity management. It's very straightforward. We have a platform that we build three products on, identity service, server suite, the first product we started with, and now privilege service. And basically, these enable a set of capabilities for these different services. So identity service does SSO to SaaS applications and on-premises applications as well, offers multi-factor authentication services, offers user provisioning into other cloud services, has built-in enterprise mobility management, some very good, very capable stuff for mobile devices, as well as management from the cloud for Mac computers. Server Suite is our traditional. It's our oldest product. It's 11 years old now. Includes Active Directory bridging, privilege management, super user privilege management. So I don't get to start a service unless I specifically ask Elevate Privilege on that box, and that's been assigned to me by a role. Auditing as well, and server and domain isolation, bringing effectively Windows IPsec to Red Hat and Solaris computers and a couple of other Linux and Unix distributions as well. Privilege Service is the new product. We talked about that earlier. Yes, 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 we do a lot of wonderful things. The thing that's most interesting about us, I think, is up in the upper right-hand corner, if you're a Centrify customer, there is a very, very good chance that as the team who works directly with us, even if you don't like us, you respect us and you'll continue to use our products. Because we have what is arguably the best support organization and best backline engineering organization for the products in the business today. We spend a lot of money on this stuff. We spend more money on support and customer success relative to the size of the business than any other company I've been at, bar none. So we take very, very good care of our customers. We do absolutely the best we can. It's a major focus of our team. There are times as a product manager, I'd like to have those resources building new stuff. But all in all, it's worked out very well for us and for our customers as well. And we're everywhere. 60 US federal agencies, 7 of the top 12 telcos worldwide, 4 out of the top 10 financial service companies, 3 of the top 5 US retailers. We're just all over the place. Nobody knows who we are, except for some segment of the IT team that's concerned about identity management for Unix or Linux or for SaaS applications. So we have 450 people now. We're growing. We've grown a lot over the last 2.5 years, especially. We've been around for 11 years. We're all over shifting to the cloud. We started off with an on-premise solution that basically took Linux computers and joined them in Active Directory. 11 years later, just over a decade later, I'm standing in front of you delivering to market the first cloud-based shared account password management system and getting some really interesting feedback from you in this session here. We deliver new technologies. We want to lead in this space. We want to do the things that you want us to do in order to manage identity securely within your environments. And we have over 5,000 customers right now worldwide. End of sales pitch. My name is Brad Zehring. I'm a product manager at Centrify.com. My colleague, David McNeely, who along with me manages both Centrify Privilege Service and Centrify Service Suite, and who's a vice president of product strategy at Centrify. Thank you very much for attending the conference and this presentation.